Here's a simple diagram. We want to create a connection between two things. You need to keep in mind that the CAN controller as a peripheral. Everyone only understands digital. It has TX and RX, which only understand digital, who then converts these to the high and low, which belong to analog, which the CAN bus understands. It's the CAN transceiver that does this, not you. So the CAN transceiver takes the logic one from you, puts it on the CAN high and CAN low, then reads the bus again and returns it to you in the RX, which is also the logic you wrote. In the diagram, it shows you the CAN high and CAN low from the outside, and the RX, which is what's inside for the CAN controller. What the CAN controller sees in the RX is the final form. But I don't understand how what goes up and down gives me a zero. That's something related to the CAN bus. We will look into it shortly. In the end, you're concerned with what comes to you as digital. How is it then translated in terms of CAN high and CAN low? The transceiver does that, and we will see how it works. If you notice in the data being sent, which is green for us, there are five zeros followed by another zero. So what happens? There's a circuit in the CAN controller called stuffing, which means it sends, and when it finds that the number of zeros reaches six, it inserts a one between the fifth and sixth. That's why we considered this one as a stuff bit, and that's why its color changed. Now, in the receive, as soon as you find there are five zeros followed by a one, you know it's a stuff bit. So in the CAN controller, it automatically removes it and connects the others together. Do you get me? Do you see how the game goes? That's why I'm telling you the CAN controller is reliable. Why? Because it has many strong mechanisms to prevent any problems. Now, what does the frame look like? The frame consists of start of frame, arbitration, control data, CRC, acknowledgement, and end of frame. All right, folks, let's dive into this one. The start of frame, commonly referred to as the SOF, has one bit in it. Now, in the arbitration field, it consists of an identifier that is 11 bits, which is known as the standard ID. After this, there's another bit named the remote transmission request. If you wish to send a remote frame instead of a data frame, then you elevate this particular bit. Moving forward, the control field contains an ID that indicates whether it's working in standard or extended mode. We've set this ID to 0, implying it's operating in standard mode, which is solely 11 bits. Then there's a reserved bit, meaning it's held aside and no one uses it. Afterwards, it has 4 bits related to something called the data length counter. This bit determines how much data you're planning to send. Stay with me. The maximum amount of data you can transmit in a classic CAN frame is 8 bytes. So in the DLC, the highest number it can go up to is 8. If it's 0, you're not sending any data. But if you set it to 1, it indicates you're dispatching just 1 byte of data. Now, here's an interesting bit. The CRC is what's present in the data link layer. The CAN controller computes the CRC for this data and then seals it with a delimiter bit. Let's wrap it up. The acknowledgement range waits for someone to reply with an acknowledgement. If no response is received, then it's as if nobody responded with an acknowledgement. Following this, there's a bit term, the acknowledgement delimiter. And then there's a sequence of 7 bits for the end of frame, which returns the bus to an idle state. After this point, it's complete. I hope that clears things up. Let's continue. All right, lean in and focus on this. When talking about the bus, the two ways that are separated from each other represent logic 0, while the ones next to each other stand for logic 1. We call this logic 1 recessive and the logic 0 dominant. Got that? Great. Now, for the start of frame, if the bus was in an idle state represented by 1 and suddenly drops to 0, this indicates the start of frame. This logic 0 is interpreted as what? It's a single dominant bit, because the dominant is what creates this pattern. This appearance emerges after the logic enters the transceiver. Stay with me. This single dominant bit marks the beginning of the data. It's as if everyone was seated and the bus was in an idle state, then suddenly one brought it down to zero, indicating the start of frame, basically sending a dominant signal. Now, the moment an ECU sends a start of frame, all the other ECUs start to listen intently. From this point on, they sync up quickly with the bit rate or the baud rate. For example, if they're operating at 1000 kilobit per second, they all begin to communicate at this speed. And that's the gist of it. Keep up, there's more to learn. All right, folks, lend me your ears and let's dive into this. When we enter the arbitration field, this determines who the winner of the bus is if both transmit at the same time. The principle we've adopted is that the lesser identifier wins the bus. There are two types of identifiers to keep in mind. There's the standard identifier, which is 11 bits. But if you decide that your CAN frame uses an extended identifier, it means the ID calls 11 plus 18, giving a total of 29 bits. So your ID will either beats or 29 bits. It's simple, right? Let's discuss the arbitration based on the standard 11-bit. Within the 11-bit range, all seems clear. Then we have the RTR, wondering what RTR is. It stands for Remote Transmission Request. Currently, we are explaining the data frame. But what distinguishes it from the remote frame? It's the RTR bit. If you set it to 1, you're dealing with a remote frame and you won't be sending any data. However, if it's a data frame, data will be transmitted as usual and serial T will be set to 0. Therefore, the author must be 0 in a data frame. Got it. Next up is the control field. It contains the ID, which indicates whether the identifier is standard or extended. If you're using the standard format, ID is set to 0. But for the extended format, it's set to 1. Now, you might ask, how do we differentiate between the standard and extended formats? Both have start of frame, RT and ID. Here's the kicker. In the extended format, something called the CR is included, which stands for Substitute Remote Request. This is set as recessive, meaning 1. It's placed adjacent to the identifier, followed by setting the ID to 1. So, when 11 is encountered after the 11 bits of the ID, it's recognized as an extended format and the subsequent 18 bits of the ID are then accepted. Now, could this happen in the standard format? The answer is no. Assuming you are using a standard remote frame and not a data frame, RT would be 1, but ID in the standard would be 0, making it 10, not 11. Wondering who does all of this? It's the data link layer's job. You just specify if you want to send in standard or extended, and it takes care of the rest. Guys, it does all of this and checks everything while you remain hands-off. It only provides you with a status. So the key differences between standard and extended are mainly the RT and the ID. And that's the crux of it. Stay tuned for more. All right, team, let's zone in on this together. So what's this DLC we're hearing about? It stands for data length counter. What does that mean? It signifies whether you're going to send 1 byte of data or 8 bytes. The maximum it can hold is 8. So after setting the DLC, it sends 8 bytes. Therefore, a CAN frame can accommodate up to 8 bytes in a single frame. Keep this in mind. Next, it sends the CRC as a checksum for this data. It's 16 bits split into 15, with 1 being a delimiter. This delimiter is recessive, which means it's set to 1. This acts as the closing mark for the CRC. Keep that in your notes. All right, let's dive into this together. After that comes the acknowledgement. As a transmitter in this acknowledgement state, I keep it idle at one. When ECU2 responds with an acknowledgement, it will send a zero. So the bus will output a zero. It's not just about what I send. When I send something, I also check on my RX in the CAN controller to see if what I received is correct or not. Upon checking, I'll find that the X received a zero, which means it's acknowledged. Following the acknowledgement, there's a delimiter, and this is always a fixed value of one. Then comes the end of the frame. The visualization here illustrates. What happened is ECU1 sent the start of frame. Look closely and you'll find the DLC is at 2-1, indicating that the data is 1 byte. After that, the CRC was sent and the subsequent part was kept idle. That's the transmission. Now let's see what ECU2 did. If you noticed, ECU2 wasn't transmitting anything, so it remained idle. I had the logic analyzer set to the TX and RX, which is digital and not related to analog. So what happened? Focus here. The RX of ECU2 was the one receiving. So whatever TX was sent reached the RX. At the same time, didn't we say that if the TX of the CAN controller sends anything on the bus, it senses the bus itself. This means that whatever is sent to the bus doesn't come back to the RX to see how it's doing. It senses to check things like arbitration or if there's a bit monitoring error, etc. We found that after ECU2's RX received everything, it finally responded with an acknowledgement. Consequently, both the RX of CAN 1 and CAN 2 saw that the bus became zero immediately. When the RX of CAN 1 noticed it received an acknowledgement, it knew there wasn't an ACK error. This confirmed that the frame was received by someone. The end of frame consists of 7 recessive bits, which means ones. These must occur before sending another frame. You can conclude these guys with something called the interframe space. What does that mean? After these 7 bits, 3 more recessive bits are added as a gap. This means that once you've completed the first frame, I create a gap of 3 bits with a value of 1. After this gap, if someone wants to send another frame, they can go ahead. It's like creating a gap between one frame and the next. I've explained the data frame. Now, let's move on to the remote frame. The remote frame is used by a node to request other nodes to send certain types of messages. What does this mean? It means that ECU1 sends a remote frame with IG100, as if it's saying, hey, whoever sends with IG100, send it to me. So if I have ECU2 sending with an ID of 10 and a ECU3 sending with an ID of 100, both of them, upon seeing this as a remote frame, will receive it. They'll check in the software and find that this remote frame wants a response based on its ID, which is 100. ECU2 will say, I have nothing to do with 100. I wasn't sending with a 100, so I won't send anything as software. However, ECU3 will realize, yes, right? I'm the one sending with the IDs of 100. Hence, someone is asking me to send, so it proceeds to send the data frame with ID 0x100. The remote frame doesn't carry data. That's why you'll find its DLC always has a value of 0. Of course, the ETAR here, its bit value is 1. Also, a remote frame can either have a standard ID or an extended ID. For instance, the remote frame here is asking how hot is the oil, and it sent the oil ID, which is the ID this node always sends with, meaning this node constantly sends with ID oil ID. So, when node B saw this, it went on to send the data frame to node A, just as you can see. What's the error frame about? Look closely because this part is tricky. To understand it, lean back a bit. I'll explain it in the last slides, not now. But I want to give some hints about it. The remote frame is divided. You're usually in an idle case. Then you send 6 bits representing the error flag. followed by another 6 bits, which are an echo, meaning you repeat the first 6 bits. After that, you send 8 delimiters, which are 8 ones. Then you wait for the gap of the interframe space, or the ifs, which is the 111 sequence. And then, that's it. This remote frame is sent whether you're a transmitter or receiver facing an issue. Let's say you receive something incorrectly, so you send a remote frame. Hence, anyone who receives this remote frame should start sending to you again, or something similar. Either the transmitter sends something and no one responded, or they send something and an error occurred, so they send another remote frame. This error flag typically holds 6 bits. These 6 can either be all dominant, meaning all zeros, or all recessive, which means all ones. If they are dominant, they represent an active error. If they are recessive, they represent a passive error.